Well, hi, my name is Dean. I'm the pastor of Lost City Church, and I want to thank you for coming and watching this video today, but I want you to go ahead and plan a visit now. And you can plan a visit by clicking on the link in the comments below, and here is why I want you to plan a visit. Because when you plan a visit, we'll have a host ready to meet you outside of our facility. They'll give you a personal tour of our location. They'll help you get your kids registered. They'll have a free gift waiting for you. They'll save you some seats in our auditorium, and they will introduce you to me, and so you and I can finally meet face to face. It's so important for you to plan your visit now, and I want to encourage you to go ahead and do that before you watch the rest of this video. And I promise you, when you come and attend Velocity, that you're going to experience God, His presence, and His goodness in your life. So plan your visit now, and then enjoy the rest of this video. God bless you, and we'll see you soon.
I also want to let you know on Christmas Eve, right? On Christmas Eve, we're going to be having church on that Sunday, and we want you here. We want you here to be part of that day. It's going to be a really, really good day on Christmas Eve. We're going to have that candlelight service. It's going to be a lot of fun. And so make sure you invite some guests. And do y'all know that's when Cody and Alicia started coming? It was a year ago. It was a Christmas Eve service, and it's been a year already. I can't believe it's been a year. It feels like it's been just a few months, but anyway, so make sure you're inviting your friends, inviting people to our Christmas Day service and everything we have going on for Easter, not Easter, but for Christmas. It's going to be really, really good. Hey, listen, last week I talked about being thankful and why being thankful is so important. And I said it's really hard to be joyful when you're not thankful. And I said, that's where joy really begins. It starts with learning to be thankful, right? How many of y'all remember that or you appreciate that word last week, right? That it starts, joyful starts with being thankful for what you have and what God's done in your life. And that's where joy begins to come and flood out of our life, flow out of us. But today I'm starting this new series called Searching for Christmas. And so what I want us to do during this next couple of weeks, I want to help you learn how to share the hope that Jesus provides and the message of Jesus throughout this Christmas season to the lost people around us. And I want you to know that it's more. Being a Christian, it's more than just saying Merry Christmas to somebody at a checkout stand at Walmart. But man, as a believer, Christmas is celebrating who Christ is in us and His message in our life every single day and sharing the hope with people. Amen? Come on, we need to share Christ this season, right? We need to figure out a way to show Christ in everything we do with our attitude, how we serve people. And one of the ways I'm doing that this week, my neighbor just suddenly passed away two doors down from where I live. And I know neither he nor his wife are believers. And so one of the ways I'm showing Christ's love during this season and in honor of this man that Charlie and I were taken by meals to his wife, that I'm going to his family celebration and celebration of life service on Tuesday. And we just been trying to serve that family and show them Jesus through our life so they can see Jesus in us. Here's the issue when it comes to sharing hope with hopeless people or messy people is this, right? That when it comes to sharing hope with people, that it's really easy to either avoid or ignore messy, hopeless people. Have you noticed that before? Think about people just in your family that seem a little messy. And how easy it is just to avoid them or ignore them. So my uncle, J.W., everyone knew him in Front Royal because he was a town drunk. That was my uncle. J.W. was a town drunk. That most times at J.W., he wouldn't spend the night in his home or my grandparents' house. He would be spending the night because he would be drunk out of his mind, and you would find him passed out on the sidewalks and streets beside buildings all over town. That was my uncle. It was easy to just for people to avoid him or to ignore JW. You know what he really needed in his heart, what he really needed Jesus in his heart and in his life. And it's easy for all of us to look at messy people in our life like JW. Maybe you have like a JW in your family or JW in your neighborhood. Maybe you have somebody that's messy in your life, and it's easy just to ignore them. It's easy just to avoid them. And that's a challenge as Christians. We got to figure out a way. How do we show the love of Jesus Christ to people like that every day? And I want to help you today. How do you learn to show the message of hope to messy, hopeless people? And we got to intentionally choose to love messy people the way that Jesus loved you, a messy person. It's easy to forget that we were a messy person at one time too, right? It's easy for us to forget. We think we have our life together. We think, you know, we have our finances together, or our relationships are together, but we forget that we are a mess before Jesus came in our life, that we were a mess, and we got to figure out ways to think, how can we show hope and the love of Jesus Christ to messy people? This is the one thing I know about loving messy people is this, that loving people the way Jesus loved people will always be messy. It will always be messy, loving people the way Jesus loved people. You know, it's easy to love people from a distance. It's what a lot of Christians do that now. We love people from a distance. We refuse to get into their world. We refuse to get into the middle of their situations or middle of their problems. We refuse to step in. Like Elizabeth was talking about, how Jesus stepped in. It's easy for us to avoid or ignore or somehow just deny that there's situations and challenges in those people's lives, but we got to figure out a way. If we're going to love people the way Jesus loved people, we got to say, hey, I'm going to be willing to get messy again. I'm going to be willing to get my hands dirty again. I'm going to be willing to walk beside this person and love this person the way that Jesus loved them. Have you ever known someone that was messy? You ever known somebody that's messy? Yeah. If you don't know somebody that's messy, I want you to know right now. I want to give you a piece of inspiration. You're the messy person. If you don't know anyone that's messy, you're the messy person. And I want to tell you about my roommate at Southeastern Bible College in Lakeland, Florida. He was a mess. On the outside, when everyone saw him around the college campus there in Lakeland, Florida, at Southeastern Bible College on that campus, when people saw him in the classes and walking down the sidewalks and, you know, in the college chapel and stuff, everyone saw him on the outside. He looked perfect. He looked flawless. He had it all together. He looked like he had it going on. Like he was like, you know, like this perfect picture of like what a perfect life should look like. But man, back in that dorm room, I want you to know he was a mess. I want you to know, I don't know how he found his clean clothes. I don't know how he ever found his wallet. I don't know how he found his backpack. I don't know how he found anything in our room, because man, that dude was just a mess. And I would tell you his name, but I'm afraid he might be watching online or see this. But I want you to know he was a mess. But today when I'm talking about messy people, not just talking about people that are a physical mess. Today I'm talking about people that are an emotional, relational, financial, a spiritual mess. And how do we respond? How do we respond to people that are a mess? Man, there's messy people in your life every single day. They may look perfect and great on the outside. They may live in a big house. They may drive a nice car. That their marriage may look perfect. Their family may look perfect. But it's interesting what goes on behind those exterior things. You'll find that probably in their heart, there's still a lot of people that on the outside, they look perfect. But on the inside, they're a mess because they're far from Jesus. Far from Jesus. But what happens to you and I, we get so stuck on just on external outside things, and we judge people based upon what they have or what they own or what they do or their accomplishments or their promotions or whatever positions of authority they have. And we think, wow, they're okay, when on the inside, they're really not okay. They're really struggling. They're still a mess. I remember as a teenager, I was a mess. On the outside, I looked okay. I looked okay. I had a nice car. I had a good paying job. I had a 1983 Camaro, man, that car was awesome. It had a 302 in it with a four barrel. I'm telling you, when I put my foot on the gas pedal, you could see the needle begin to move. Man, that car could get up and move. I remember I had that car, and a Mustang came up to me one night, and he revved up his engine, and he was right beside me. I revved up my engine, and so you know what that means? That means this guy wants to race. And so, man, he hit his accelerator. I hit my accelerator, and we go down about a half a mile. We're going back and forth. And next thing I know, my car, my transmission in my Camaro just blows up basically and disintegrates. And that Mustang keeps on driving down the road. But I want you to know, on the outside, a lot of people looked at my life thinking, man, he's got it all together. He's got it right. He's got the friends. You know, he's got a great job. But I want you to know, on the inside, I was a mess. I was far from God. On the outside, it looked like I was okay. But on the inside, I was far from God. On the inside, I was an alcoholic that no one could see on the outside. But I was that alcoholic as a young adult. I was a suicidal pastor's kid. Sounds like an acronym, right? Those words don't belong together. That's who I was. On the outside, I looked okay. But on the inside, I was a mess. I was a suicidal pastor's kid. I said in church almost every single Sunday. I went to youth group almost every single Wednesday night. I knew all the right things to say. I knew when to lift my hands. I knew when to keep my hands down. I knew all that stuff. I knew all the motions and actions, but it looks like I'm okay on the outside. On the inside, I was a mess. And it wasn't until my best friend's mom, Imogene Ringer, what she did, she saw through my mess. She saw my heart. She looked through my mess. In spite of all the stuff and things that were going on in my life, she looked past my mess, and she showed the hope of Jesus to my heart. She looked beyond my superficial exterior, and she saw how desperate and broken I was on the inside, and she was able to speak to those things in my life and show me Jesus on the, despite things going on in my life. I appreciate Imogene Ringer so much and what she's done in my life. Here's what I've learned about a mess and what I learned about Jesus. I learned this over the last few years. I've learned that Jesus loves me and loves you through my mess. Some of you are thinking, wow, Jesus can never love me because of my mess. But Jesus loves you in spite of your mess, right? I've learned this. I've learned that Jesus loves me in spite of my mess. I've learned that Jesus, he's not intimidated by my mess. Jesus is not intimidated by your mess. He's not intimidated by your addictions, by your struggles, by your temptations, by your habits. Jesus is not intimidated by the mess inside of your life. And I want you to know, Jesus is not intimidated by the mess in other people's lives around you either. Jesus is not overwhelmed. He's not overwhelmed by those things. It doesn't catch him by surprise. It doesn't catch Jesus off guard. He already knows your mess, and he's willing to still step into your mess. He's still willing to bring you hope. He's still willing to help you to see who he is. I love this about Jesus. What I've learned, Jesus isn't going to avoid me or ignore me because of my mess. Did you hear me just now? Jesus doesn't ignore me or avoid me, Dean Rawls, because of my mess even today. When I struggle with lust or some of those thoughts, I'm 54 years old, and I remember thinking as a teenager, man, once I get married, once I put that ring on that finger, man, I'm never going to struggle with these kinds of thoughts, lustful thoughts, and see a beautiful woman. I'm never going to struggle with that again. Man, that was such a lie from the devil. Just because I have a ring on my finger, man, I still struggle with some of those things from time to time. I still struggle with other areas of my life from time to time. But I'm learning, when I struggle with those other areas of my life, that Jesus is still willing to come in, and he doesn't avoid me because of those things. He doesn't ignore me because of those things. I think because of those things, Jesus actually wants to walk closer by my side. Jesus actually wants to show me more grace. He actually wants to show me more love. And as I experience those things in my life, what happens? I'm so ready to begin to experience God's love and share that with other people. I believe this. I believe God wants all of us to love people the same way Jesus loved people. Are you loving people around you? The messy people. I'm not talking about the easy people that are easy to love. I'm talking about messy people. Are you able to love the messy people that are around you the same way Jesus would love them? How do you do that? What did Jesus do? We're going to look at the story in John chapter 1. And what we're finding out about this story that we're going to look at these scriptures here in a second is this, that we're learning John, who wrote the Gospel of John. We know a couple of things about him. John was a fisherman, so he knew a lot about messy things. If you ever been fishing, who likes to fish? You ever been fishing? Raise your hand. Yeah, a lot of us, right? We know how messy fishing is. John knew about a mess. So he and his brother James, they were both fishermen. And we know this about John. John was greatly loved by Jesus. Jesus actually chose John to come follow him. He was one of Jesus's closest friends. John, he was part of Jesus's inner circle. Of Peter, James, and John, right? The inner circle. We know John, he was a witness to a lot of crazy miracles and things that happened in Jesus' life. John was there on the mountain when Jesus was transfigured, the mountain of transfiguration, when Jesus went on top of his mountains, and it says that heavens opened up and Jesus became brilliant and had all these godlike characteristics and qualities in his life. And on top of this mountain, he actually saw Moses and Elijah on top of this mountain. John was there. John saw that happen. John was there when he saw Jairus, when Jesus raised Jairus' daughter back to life. John saw it. John saw what happens when Jesus loved messy people. That John was there. John saw these things. John saw it when Jesus went into the Garden of Gethsemane and Jesus was praying and he was arrested. John saw what it looked like to get messy and have a messy kind of love and love people the way Jesus would love people. We know this about John too. He wrote not only the Gospel of John, he also wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. He also wrote the book of Revelation. We know this about John too. He was persecuted for his faith. Do you remember that? And he was exiled to an island called what? Do you remember? Patmos, right? And on this island, when he was exiled there, right? He was exiled on this island, and it was on that island that God gave him, all these different visions about the future and things that were to happen. And he compiled, he wrote all those things down, and he wrote those things down in the book we know now called what? The book of Revelation. And so this is John. This is John. I want you to see today that, John knew a lot about Jesus. John knew a lot about how do you love people the way Jesus loved people that were messy. And I want you to see what was happening. And so why did John write these verses we're about to look at? And here's a couple of reasons. John wanted everyone to know Jesus' true identity. John wanted everybody to know that this kid being born in a manger, just not just your normal baby. This is actually Jesus, the Son of God. And the second reason why John wrote these verses is that John wanted everyone in the world to know that there's hope. John wanted everyone to know that there's hope for messy people. There's hope for broken people. John wanted everyone to know that it's only through Jesus Christ can you have a restored relationship with God again. Even when you mess up, John wanted people to know that, when Jesus comes in your life, he can come in and change you and restore you and, forgive you and bring healing in your life. I want you to know this was John's heart. And so John was so careful about showing the love of Jesus to everyone. And so this is why he wrote these verses. I want us to read this together. It's in John chapter 1. It says this. It says, he, Jesus, came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. Then the last part says this. So the Word became human. Jesus became human, and he made his home among us. And we have seen his glory and the glory of the Father, one and only Son. This is some powerful verses. I want you to think for a second. Think what Jesus is. It doesn't tell us, but imagine what Jesus' life was like before he was born in a manger. Because Jesus existed from the beginning of time, right? So think about this for a moment. Jesus was in paradise. He was in heaven, right? So imagine Jesus is now in heaven before he's born in a manger. Think about this. Walk with me for a second, right? So think about Jesus. He was constantly surrounded by these gorgeous gates. He's surrounded by these costly stones. He's surrounded by these clear jasper. He's surrounded by these beautiful rivers. He's surrounded by these lush trees. He's surrounded by passionate worship. He's surrounded by these spacious mansions. He's surrounded by these majestic thrones. And he's surrounded by these powerful angels. Man, Jesus was in this perfect place, but Jesus was still willing to come. That Jesus saw our mess and he came. And that's why John tells us in verse 10 that Jesus, he saw us, that we were a mess, and he was still willing to come and love us in spite of our mess. Remember, it says this. We just read this in verse 10. It says this. His world was a mess, and his world didn't even recognize him. The world's so messed up, man. Think about our world today, the world that you and I, we both live in. Just because I'm a pastor, just because I have a title pastor, I still live in the same world that you live in. I still see the same challenges and problems and how far our world is from the things of God, how God created it. And it says this, I'm going to go back to this. It says that, so this world is a mess. The world did not recognize him. Think about how many people today, even on their deathbed, will still refuse to recognize that Jesus is the Son of God. This world, it is a mess. But we need to share the hope that comes from Jesus and who is Jesus. In verse 11, the world is a mess, but also the people is a mess. The verse says this, it says, his people. It was his people. His people, Jesus' people, his own people rejected him. Man, that we're a mess. His people, that we're a mess. Aren't you glad that no one's perfect in here? No one's perfect except for Charlene, and she's not in this room right now, but y'all can tell her that. I'm earning brownie points right now with my relationship with my wife. But no one is perfect. I want you to see, even Jesus saw the world would reject him, his very own people. So even though Jesus saw these things, Jesus knows everything, right? He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. He's all-powerful, all-knowing. He knew even though the world would reject him, even though the world would recognize, Jesus was still willing. That's a key word right there. The Holy Spirit keeps putting in my heart all week. Willing. Willing. Jesus was willing to still come. Jesus was still willing to come, even knowing what a mess our world was. Jesus was still willing to come, even though he knew what a mess you and I are. Jesus still was willing to come in his love. He was willing. He still came and became flesh. He didn't just appear to be human. Jesus actually came and became a human. Did you get that? Even despite his willingness to leave perfect paradise, he came in earthly and human form. He became flesh. And not only did he become flesh, that what happened, that he came and he dwelt among us. So think about this for a second, right? Like Elizabeth was talking about a little earlier during her time, she was sharing some things the Holy Spirit was sharing with us. But I want you to see, again, what Elizabeth was talking about, why it's so powerful, why Jesus came and dwelt among us. Because like she said in the Old Testament, what happened, people would have to go to God. But before they could go to God, they had to go to the priest first, right, at the tabernacle. And then, so they would go, they would bring usually their sacrifice. They would give their sacrifice to the priest. They would slaughter the priest as a sacrifice before the Lord, atonement for their sins. And then these priests would go into the Holy of Holies where the Ark of the Covenant was, right? And that's where the absolute presence of God came down. And so what would happen, we would have to go to God in the Old Testament. We would have to go to God. It was a labor. So it was a timely, expensive thing to go to God in the tabernacle in the Old Testament. But what we see when Jesus dwelt among us, what that means, instead of us going to God, what happened, God came to us. Come on. Come on, God came to us. Come on. God comes to us. God comes to you. God comes to you. And so the Old Testament, we had to go to God. And what happens now, we see that God comes to us. He comes in our messiness every day. And it's not just limited to a four-wall building. What happens, he comes into every part of our life. He comes when we're struggling. He comes when we're frustrated. He comes in when we're parenting our kids. He comes in when we're trying to figure out our parents. And what happens, he comes in. He comes in. And as Christians, what we've done is that we've limited God to only certain places or times in our life. And what God wants to do, Jesus wants to come in every single area and every single place of our life, every single day of our life. He wants to come in. Will we let him in? Man, imagine what your life would look like if in every situation, in every place, everywhere, at any time, you let Jesus in. Imagine how different your life would look. Imagine how different the people's lives around you will look because they would see Jesus everywhere you would go. Jesus would go too. Because you let him in your life. And so that means when I go to Patrick Henry Mall and people are getting on my nerves on Black Friday, guess what? I let Jesus in. So now I'm taking Jesus now to Patrick Henry Mall. And so one of those people around you in your family, whoever it is, you're taking Jesus with you when you let Jesus in. And so what happened again? So Jesus still came and became flesh, even though we were messy. And Jesus also came and he dwelt among us, even though that we were messy. I'm so thankful for Jesus. Aren't you thankful? Oh my goodness, I'm so thankful. Jesus didn't ignore or avoid messy people. Think about like all the different stories in the New Testament we know about Jesus. How Jesus intentionally chose to love messy people. It happened time and time again. Jesus intentionally chose to go to them. Jesus chose to take the hope, the message to them. I want you to know, Jesus loved messy people despite their negativity and their hatred. Don't you know there's a lot of negativity and hatred in our world today, right? Amen? But don't you know our world needs to see the love of Jesus despite hatred, despite negativity. They need to see love inside of you and inside of me. They need to see Jesus in you and me. They don't need to see more hatred or more bitterness from you and me. And that's what the world is seeing from the church so much. They're seeing since COVID, they're seeing so much hate from the church. And then that's why we become poison and we're pushing people away from the good news and the gospel of Jesus Christ, because that's all they see from us, the church, is hatred and criticism and negativity. And that's why the church needs to come in and full of the power of the Holy Spirit and full of the love of God. And everywhere we go, even though we may be around people we don't agree with, even though we're around people that they may be have a different set of beliefs or values, we have to walk with the love of Jesus in our life, and we got to love them and serve them with through the power of the Holy Spirit, and so they can see Jesus in our life. One of my favorite, one of my best friends in high school, his name was Jason Daniels. Jason Daniels, man, he was so far from God. I was struggling with my own relationship with God, but I was still trying to bring Jesus in. And I knew something about Jason. I knew Jason, he was a Mormon. I knew he had no similar values, what I believed. I knew his life wasn't based on the Word of God or having a relationship with Jesus Christ. But even though I was struggling with alcohol and struggling with my identity, who I was, I still tried to bring Jesus in. Imagine if you began to bring Jesus in. Imagine if you began to love Jesus the way Jesus loved messy people despite their sins and failures. Man, can you see that brother or sister may be struggling with homosexuality? What about instead of looking at them with hate, what if you begin to look at them with God's love? What if you begin to serve them and to pray for them and surround them with godly love? Not accepting their lifestyle choices. I'm not talking about accepting that. But I am talking about having the God-like, Christ-like attitude that would love them, see them as Jesus sees them. Because they're struggling with sin, just like you struggle with sin. Stop categorizing sin and thinking one sin is worse than the other, because you have your own struggles. You have your own challenges. You have your own sins you're dealing with. And Jesus needs to come into your life, and you need to let Jesus come into their life and let Jesus. So Jesus loved people in spite. Despite their sins or their failures. Jesus loved messy people despite their gender or their age. And so we need to look at people through the eyes of Jesus and say, hey, even this person is a different gender than you are, a man, you're a woman, or whatever. You got to love them with the love of Jesus. And we got to see people. We got to love people, too. It doesn't matter their age. Amen? Jesus loved people despite their education or wealth. It's interesting how we respond to people that have a higher education or more money differently than people that have no title and no education. We love them differently. So people that we know have a high promotion or they're in place of high authority as a coach, as the colonel or general, whatever, we have a different posture about us. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. A person that has no job, no income, no salary, our love values change. But as Christ believers, our love values should still be the same. No matter who we're around, no matter who we're with, we should show them the love of Jesus. Jesus loved messy people despite their social status or their personal history. I love how Jesus showed us how to love people. Here's my question today. I'm wrapping up. Are you willing to love messy people the way Jesus loved messy people? Are you really? Are you really? Are you willing to love messy people the way Jesus loved them? Lost messy people around you may never know God, find freedom, discover purpose, or make a difference unless you're willing. There's that word again. Just having a willingness to say, hey, I'm willing to love. I'm willing to show people hope. I'm willing to show Jesus to them. They're not worthy. They're not worthy of Jesus' name, but I'm still going to show them the love of Jesus, even though they're not worthy. They may be far from God, but I'm still going to show them Jesus. Tuesday, I'm going to get in a suit. I hate wearing suits. I can't stand suits. I got like 10 suits in my closet. They just stay hanging on those hangers until a funeral or wedding. I hate wearing suits. But on Tuesday, I'm going to get on my nicest suit. I'm going to polish my shoes. I'm going to freshen up the best I can. And I'm going to go serve that family that I know that are far from God. And they have kids and grandkids that are far from God. Because what's going to happen? Because I'm letting Jesus in my own life. When I go to that funeral, I'm going to let Jesus in that room. See Jesus through me. Let my hands, Jesus, be your hands. Let my words, Jesus, be your words. Let my attitude be your attitude. Let my thoughts be your thoughts. Jesus, let my feet be your feet. Jesus, I'm letting you in. Now, Jesus, be in anywhere I go. Jesus, use me. And Jesus wants to do the same thing in your life, but we got to be willing. We got to be willing. We got to be willing to let him in. How will people discover, how will people know God unless you're willing to show the love of Jesus through you? So how do you show the love of Jesus? Two things, two quick things. Here we go. Two easy ways how we show hope to messy people. The first way is this. The first thing you need to do, the first way we show hope is this, showing messy people more empathy. Yes. Amen. Thank What is empathy? Some of you don't know what empathy is. What empathy is you're putting yourself in that person's shoes. You're trying to think the way they think. You're trying to feel the way they feel. You're trying to see the way they see. That's called empathy. When I was a psychology major at Southeastern College, along with a ministerial major, I was a double major until I found out it's going to take me like 7 years to graduate Bible college. So I dropped my psychology degree, but now I have a psychology minor. So they tell you in psychology, when you're counseling with someone, get yourself in their shoes. Feel what they feel. Think how they think. See how they see. And imagine if during this Christmas season, when you're around messy people, you begin seeing what they see like they see. You begin to feel some of the things that they feel. And I promise you, when you start to get more empathetic with people, your attitude is going to be differently. You're going to find it very easy to love people when you're empathetic for people. It's going to be a lot easier. So I want you all to do that. And the second thing I want you to do is this. I want you to learn how to show messy people more compassion this Christmas season. And you're like, well, Pastor Dean, isn't empathy and compassion, isn't that the same thing? It's close, but it's a little different. Empathy is understanding their feelings or their attitudes or seeing the world the way they sees it. They see it. What happens, the difference with compassion is taking action and doing something that would help them. And so that's what we need to do as a church this Christmas season. We need to say, hey, I'm going to love messy people the way Christ loved messy people. I'm going to show empathy, but I'm also going to show some compassion. I'm actually going to go do something and say something that's going to help somebody instead of just saying, God bless you. Have a great day. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. I hope you have a great day. I know you're struggling financially right now, but God bless you. And that's what we do as a church instead of saying, hey, what can I do? What has God given me that could be a blessing to this person in their life? How can God use me in their life? What can I say in their life that can restore some hope, that can bring some purpose back in their life? What can I give? How can I serve them? And so we need to be people that are more empathetic and people that are more compassionate. And that's how you can show the message and hope of Jesus Christ this Christmas season to messy people. Would y'all stand with me this morning? Hallelujah. I'm done. I hope this helps you today, because I know this about Jesus. When Jesus came in your life, you were a mess. And so what happens when you're around people that are messy people? Instead of quickly judging them or criticizing for their choices or their decisions or their actions, what you need to do is say, hey, I'm going to love this person the way Jesus loved me. I was playing this message the other day, man. I was sitting in my favorite chair in my bedroom. I was writing this message. The Holy Spirit speaking some things to me. And just, and tears just began to flow. The tears just began to flow. I was just thinking, Jesus, yeah, I just can't imagine. I would have been so easy for Jesus just to ignore or avoid. And maybe you're the same way. You're like, man, Jesus, you should just avoid or ignore me because I'm such a mess. But I want you to know God's grace is so good, and he wants to come in. Would everyone close their eyes for a moment? I want all of us to pray today. We want to let Jesus in. Maybe you've been a mess. There's areas in life that's a mess right now. You know it. You've been trying to hide it from people, but there's some things that are just a mess. And you want Jesus to come in and heal some things and restore some things to remove some things. If that's you today, I want to pray for you right now. Will you pray this prayer for me? Dear Jesus, I want you to come in. I'm a mess. I want you to come in to forgive areas of my life that's been a sin, that's gotten my way with you. Lord, I want to be free, and I want you to come in my life and give me power. Forgive me of my sin. I acknowledge my sin, and I repent today, and I want you to fill my life with your power and with your glory again. Jesus, come in every area of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. I also want to pray for people today. Maybe it's been difficult for you to love somebody because you've been looking through them with the wrong attitude, the wrong eyes, and you want to love people the way Jesus wants you to love people. Can I just ask you, raise your hand, how many of y'all, you're that person? You want to start loving people the way Jesus wants you to love people. You've not been loving people that way, but you want to begin. I believe God's going to help you today. I want to pray for you. Lord, I lift up and pray for any person today that wants to start this new love journey, that, Lord God, you would begin to help them to see people, that, Lord, how you would want them to see people and begin to serve people and help people the way you want them to serve and help people. Lord, allow the Holy Spirit to give them fresh eyes. Allow the Holy Spirit to give them fresh hearing, Lord God. Would you give them insight and supernatural power that comes from the throne of God to begin to be Jesus with skin on everywhere they go? Lord, would you begin to pour more love and new love, Christ-like love in their hearts, so anywhere and everywhere they go, they'll begin to love people, Jesus, the way you did. Lord, thank you for what you're doing in our life. We give you praise and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, 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 hallelujah, hallelujah, hallujah. Just curious, how many of y'all would say, hey, Pastor, I'm going to start loving people the way Jesus loved people, right? You're going to do that? And I believe when you do, I imagine your friends and your family, people, your neighbors are going to see Jesus in your life. So do that this week. Start it today. Love people the way Jesus would love people.